It's my great pleasure to introduce Shalini. Shalini Sankarshana is Executive Vice President at Broadridge Financial Services, and she's spent a couple of decades in the financial services industry. And you know, she's really been a what's the word I'm looking for? It's groundbreaking in terms of you know, structuring the organization, the product management function within the organization, and the investment banking space. For those of you who are familiar with financial services, the investment banking space is a very global marketplace. Yet there are you know, concerns about the decentralization of the product management function, accepting new technologies in those environments. So to that extent, Shalini has been really charting a new path in terms of balancing the priorities and the growth of the organization, along with balancing the needs of the customer community. And you know, we're really fortunate for her to be here. She travels extensively. She was just telling me that if this was next week, she would not have been able to make it. And so really, you know, thanks a lot, Shalini, for taking the time to be here. And we are very fortunate at IPL to have her as a well-wisher, and she's spoken at many events in the past. So without further ado, thank you, Shalini. And let's make this as interactive, and like I said, extract as much as you can. And I want to see that in action.
Thank you, Mr. Rao. Can you hear me on?
Yes.
Hi, good to see you. Thanks for spending so many weekends and learning it. So it just shows me that, you know, you're all passionate about product management. So I'm going to keep walking around because I don't have slides. I saw several shades of disappointment on the faces. Do you have slides?
No, absolutely not.
Thank you. I'm tired of making PowerPoint slides, yeah? So I mean, Bindu tried to coax me into getting some material, and it's with Dr. Maria if she's in the room. So, but we said, no, let's make it interactive. Rahul has been very kind in talking about me being groundbreaking, I'm not sure. I'm definitely breaking all my frequent flyer mile records. So let's start. When I was thinking of what to talk about in this group, right, I was looking at the composition of the group. It was very interesting that, you know, you come from various backgrounds. So I was thinking of, do we talk about product management as a discipline? But that's what you're already learning now, right? I'm not sure what is going up there. And then I was trying to see if there are things that we can talk in terms of the softer aspects of product management, the skills that you really are not taught in a classroom. Skills, a lot of you in your own job roles are already probably part of working. That again can be fairly generic, isn't it? So it would become like another psychology class. So I was thinking then, maybe it's best that I stick to educating you a little bit of where I come from, financial services. I didn't see too many participants in that domain. And also I thought I will talk about two aspects. One is product management today, globally, what is happening. A lot of you from your multinational organizations would be part of this, even if you're not in product management. And we'll give you a glimpse of what's going on. Second is, how do we do this locally? I think that's why I put the subject matter as, can we do global product management locally? And it's easier said than done, and I'll talk to you a little bit about it. So this is fairly my agenda for the day, right? So I really wanted to stop me and we can go in all directions based on what the class feels like. But this is where I'm thinking we'll talk about. Does that make sense? Yeah? Good, I'm getting a lot of nods. I think I was just talking to Rahul about an example of what a product manager would be in a banking industry. How many of you have already started depositing your 500 rupee notes and your withdrawing money? Only one? Oh, a few of you.
Depositing or withdrawing? Depositing or withdrawing?
So you have seen how the banking organization in India is really transforming itself to manage the overall economic impact of this. Do you see that? right? I mean, I don't know how many of you have given thought about it. There are enough WhatsApp jokes about comparing a bank officer to a soldier, etc. But I won't go that far. I'm just trying to give you an example of, look at the, I mean, today I went to one of the banks, right? HDFC Bank. That was the reason I was 5 minutes late. And I'm seeing my investment relationship manager, that's all he's been doing, you know, he's been talking about mutual funds and hedge funds for me for the last several years. Today, he's the guy who's standing in front of the bank door, bringing in the crowd. He's doing crowd management when the lines being jumped. He's getting in people inside. He's making sure he's optimizing the teller or the account person's efficiency. He's managing their times. He's seeing where is a senior crowd versus women crowd versus men crowd. I found that phenomenon very interesting. And I was thinking back, this is probably what we all do as part of the product management job. We really don't have a set job description, right? And that is what makes this job both interesting, very hard, okay? Probably of all through these courses, Rahul and Bindu and you have been telling you that it's very easy to do this job.
No, we don't
know. Sorry if I'm disillusioning you, right? But it needs, I think the word he really used was interesting. It needs that innate curiosity. Curiosity about several things. Because imagine living in an uncertain world, right? It's not easy. You have enough uncertainty on your personal part of the world. You at least want some structure in the rest of the world, which is your professional. And look at this uncertainty in several aspects. Let's spend a few minutes on what do we mean by this uncertainty. Let's look externally, right? In all of our sectors, we're working with our customers, marketplace. Hey, there's a lot of uncertainty over the last decade. So, I just want a couple of examples from any of you in the class on what you are seeing as you believe is uncertainty in your customers or in your marketplace. Anybody? Yes.
We see a lot of consolidation. Companies buying.
Can you just tell me where you're from?
I'm from Scopsis.
Okay.
So this is like the EDA sector. So every company out there which is making hardware products and chips, they use our software, right? So every year, virtually every year, we see a lot of consolidation. Bigger companies buying bigger companies, and now a lot of this investment sector, those guys are coming and buying technology companies, and they're trying to make a business out of that, and make it profitable, and then what is not profitable is being slowly shelled away. Right? Consolidation is a big thing which we try to manage.
Sure. So I'm going to try to use the board a bit, okay? Just to make down points. Do you have a marker? This one? So, consolidation. I look at this as an effect. Correct me if I'm wrong. Cause for this is probably, do you think cost pressures? Higher focus on profitability,
profitability,
or is it general macroeconomic uncertainty?
Many times you are seeing consolidated.
Sorry?
They have a bigger business case when they are consolidated.
Correct.
One is growth. People are trying to grow.
Okay.
And they are trying to get into other verticals. Like Intel is trying to go into higher risk space. So they have bought many companies in that context. Whereas the product that always was plastics for.
Okay, I'll note that down. We'll figure it out, okay, as we go along this class. So you mentioned growth. My counter to that is they've always been trying to grow. Every business tries to grow. So what is different? Somebody talked of business cases growing. So again, it goes back to growth. Anything else? Cost.
Cost of ownership.
Okay.
Customer aspirations are growing. They're not happy with the current products, so they want to be
growing. Okay.
Technology changes.
Technology change, is that a cause or is it something which is enabling all these changes?
Enabler.
I'll put technology somewhere, but I don't think it's a cause.
Okay? It could be also uncertainty because I don't know if I'm on one particular technology, I don't know what is going to happen next month or next year. Something new will come up.
I understand that, but when you're on technology sales kind of perspective, it becomes. Anything else as an uncertainty example?
Financial.
Somebody in the last bench, or last whatever row.
Everyone is actually looking to go digital business transformation. They're all looking towards the digital business.
Digital so transformation is one of the effects.
One of the causes I would say which is a common thread across all those four things that you're talking about.
Okay. Digital transformation. Okay, I think that is a cause. I agree.
Individual strategy, moving to cloud, which are this kind of strategy.
Okay, for me, all that comes to technology, right?
Economic uncertainties. Some company doesn't work. For example, China was down for the last 3 years. So it had a global impact on the overall assumption.
Scale.
What was the point about scale?
Scaling is more required now than 3 years back.
Scaling is required more now compared to 2 years back.
Years
Sorry, back. Which sector are you from? Are you talking about particularly about your in general?
Any consumer.
Is it from India or is it from a different part?
World. Be it healthcare, be it consumer, requirement.
Scalability.
Scale.
I'll take that point the pinch of salt because scalability can be relative to where you are, either as a sector, as a market, as a company, as an individual. You know, I think scale is a very relative word.
Market.
Okay.
Because quite a very generic example is telecom or mobile. People who use phones. 1 year back, I think the number of people who use phones itself doubles next year.
Right.
And that has been happening over the last year.
Understood. Okay. Let me note that down.
Same with banking.
So we'll talk about scale a little differently, okay? I'll put this as one of the effects. It's not so much as cost. Because you've all gone through the product life cycle. So as you're moving away from inception to establishment and growth phase, you're bound to solve the scale issue, right? You want to sell to more. So it's not just the factor of this time zone, right? So that's why I said it's a relative thing. Sorry, somebody else had a point. We'll take a one last point and
business model, particularly business model. For example, now in the retail space, so I don't know when e-commerce space will going to take over completely. So the whatever infrastructure I build in retail may not be viable to have a business in the long run. So that is uncertainty. So I don't know how much would I put a capex there in the retail business.
Excellent point. Okay.
Movement towards enhanced automation, which some people perceive as being detrimental to jobs.
So we are talking about uncertainty here, right?
Right.
For me, that's a little bit of an effect thing. We'll talk about it. Okay.
Actually, there's one more thing where the speed with which all these causes, the speed with which all these causes are impacting innovation and failures and recurring things that are happening, and the information, the cycle is getting shorter and shorter.
That's an excellent point. For me, the whole change has been about time and speed. We had all these things over several decades. I mean, we've had industries for how long now, right? We've had industrial age hundreds of years ago. The reason all this is, the uncertainty is becoming harder is because of the speed. Because technologies are changing not in decades, but in a matter of years. Your customer base is changing. Your customer base was 50, 40, 50 years old for a long time for us from India. Let's just take the India part of it, right? And now the user base has predominantly gone down. It's the 20s and 30s. So aspirations are different. How we operate is different. Economies are growing very, very differently. The same financial market. How many of you are aware of just basic stock trading, right? Share, buy and sell, nothing much. Basic buy and sell trading has changed, right? Several years ago, there was Dalal Street. You have to call up the broker, you have to tell, you had to know all the scripts, you have to say, buy at this price, sell at this price after a certain time. What is happening now in a matter of nanoseconds? And human beings are also not doing. You all know about the whole dark pool trading, right? If you have seen the movies, you don't have to have an MBA in finance for it. So, you have machines doing it today in a matter of not even nanoseconds, I don't know, lesser than that. And you have markets crashing and coming up in a matter of a day. How often that used to happen? Have you ever heard of a stock market crashing and coming up the same day and again trading is being resuming in our parents' generation? No. So I think it's about the speed. So the reason I brought this point up in terms of uncertainty and speed is, as product managers, our roles are becoming extremely, extremely critical in how do we manage the speed. That's why you have models like agile product management, etc. coming up. But agile is now being a fragile and badly used and over cliched word. We call anything which doesn't have a process as agile. Okay. So I just want to make sure I make that statement here. I have a lot of pain around that statement. So building enterprise level solutions in an agile model doesn't mean that we let go of everything, but it's needed when you have to come back to spring. That's one part. Let's talk of a few other things. We spoke of digital transformation. I think that's a very interesting phenomenon. And on the financial services, so let me just give you a quick background of where I come from, right? I work for a firm called Broadridge Financial Solutions. This firm has been in existence for the last 56 years or so. Originally headquartered in New York. It was not called Broadridge then. I don't even know what it was called. It was different before I was born. So it has itself undergone several stages of transformation. But the platforms that we have had over the last 55 years still run. The same mainframes still run. We have our systems process about just in one asset class, okay? You have several types of assets in stock markets, right? You have bonds, you have shares, you have derivatives like your options, you have commodities like gold and cotton and oil. So let's just take a simple example of a bond. Our platforms process about $6 trillion a day, just in bonds. And which are these platforms? The same 55-year-old platforms, okay? So think of that in the context of all this uncertainty going on. The reason I'm bringing it up is it brings a very interesting aspect in as a product manager's role, right? One is you need to continue to focus on your core of having accurate, dependable, efficient products or processes. You just cannot break that rule. That's your roti kapda makan. Whatever you do has to be on top of it, correct? On top of it, you need to still make sure you run a platform like this in the marketplace. So I'll tell you what it means. A product manager in my organization has to go through a few things. I wanted to just link back to your personal experiences and we can just share, right, and help. Few things, right? A product manager in my org has to understand this, just on this platform, if I make a certain change, let's say I'm adding a feature to download more data in this particular asset class. That's a simple requirement, right? Think of a simple business analyst writing a story card saying that I have all my trades coming in from an X kind of a customer, and I would like to extract all that data from your database and put it up. Let's assume that such a report does not exist today in the product, which is, doesn't make sense, but yeah, as an example. Just for that, there are at least 10 things he or she has to look at. One is, by adding this download, how many of my other banking broker dealer customers who are running on this platform are going to get affected? It's a very simple technology problem. People will say, oh, this, to manage performance and data issues, we have enough technology constraints that can solve for it. Think of the first question. The first question is, by doing this, how am I affecting all my other customers? Very important question. And this will apply in all the enterprise platforms, okay? Second question. Second question is, why is this person is even interested in this customer? Why only this customer? Should be the first question I should be asking. Then I should be going back and seeing what is the amount of data that's going on with this customer. Is there something going on with this customer in his trading activity? Nobody asked me to look at that question. Why am I looking at it? Obviously, I am looking at what could be the causes. Is he growing more business with this customer? Or do we believe in the marketplace this customer is losing his credibility? Credit ratings are going down. Is there a risk exposure which is higher? And which other banking clients of mine are actually talking to that customer? Should I be forewarning them? Or should I make sure, because it's an anonymous request from a client, I maintain the client confidentiality? So there are several questions for that one request, okay? I don't expect a product manager with 2 years of experience who comes into my team to think of this and understand this, but this is the kind of discussion or thinking we should be encouraging in our teams as we grow along, because this is a real example that's happening. Think of the same scenario in 2008 when Lehman crisis happened, right? We had we had about 70% of our trades from across multiple clients going through Lehman. Was it our job to get up and say to the Federal Reserve and marketplace that when this crashes, this is the effect that's going to happen? Or as a product manager, should I sit back and say, this is not what I was asked for? I don't know what's going on in the market. I don't know what's going on in, I'm sitting in India, in Bangalore, or Hyderabad, or Delhi. Should I worry about it? Okay. So I'm just giving you an example of the level of uncertainty that's going on. And think of making a change to an enterprise application like this and come back to the speed question, okay, that somebody brought up. So all this with the aspiration like our front office, which is our advisors, right, investment advisors. You have your bank guys call you, relationship managers, ask you to invest more. They are pretty much the most simplified definition of investment advisor for you, right? There's a whole marketplace for it. These investment advisors, today the trend is, they believe the marketplace is all about millennials. You no longer need human beings advising. They want robotic advisors, okay? We're actually getting into robotic advisors. Think of robotic advisors, think of $6 trillion in transactional on the mainframe platform, and in between you are sitting, okay, as a product manager. So the reason I want to give you this landscape is, this is what is happening globally, and these are the uncertainties already existing just in the business, the external uncertainties part of it, okay? I'll take a pause here. Any thoughts, questions, and I want a couple of you to just talk about your examples of what's going on in your sectors, so that we can kind of consolidate our thoughts. Yes.
Yeah, so I'll just add to what you were saying, because I also come from the semiconductor industry.
Okay.
So what we're seeing happen is several causes. One is the technology side of it is becoming it's become very expensive now to design chips at the lower demand. That's one factor. The other factor that you're actually seeing is mobile industry, reliance on mobile industry. So once Apple just said that one of the quarters their sales is saturated or negative, okay, you saw the entire industry. I think that's what kind of triggered off a lot of acquisitions that's happening. Now the one thing that I want to understand, there is uncertainty on the design side. It's a very capital intensive thing if you want to invest in new areas. And the other part is the investors.
Right.
So because it's capital intensive, or I mean, you need to pump in a lot of money into R&D. Even if one quarter, you cannot absorb the shock.
Mm.
Okay. So now you're looking for newer growth areas, like IoT is a newer growth area. So there are two reasons. One is the mobile industry kind of saturating or declining. The other is you're looking for a new growth area. So these are the aspects. Now from the investor point of view, it looks like all these decisions, at least for the people who are working in that industry,
mm-hmm.
it looks to us that it's driven by the investors,
mm-hmm.
the guys who actually hold stake. Okay, now this is how I want to pose that question to you.
Sure.
This is an industry which has existed for more than four decades, 1970. Okay, it has fueled a lot of growth. Okay, but what we are seeing now, okay, it's about 330 plus billion dollar revenue globally as an entire industry, and within 18 months, the kind of acquisitions that have happened, okay, you can name the big ones. It's touching, the valuations are touching 200 billion in 18 months. So you see NXP, Freescale, Qualcomm. The NXP and Freescale, the leaders in automotive. Qualcomm is leader in mobile. They just acquired, NXP acquired Freescale, Qualcomm is acquiring NXP now. So it's like mobile, people who have already been investing a lot in the mobile industry are now trying to jump into the biggest growth area they want to see. Samsung acquiring Harman. So there's a lot of acquisitions that are happening, consolidation, which we feel is driven more by the investors because they see that their returns are shrinking. So my personal opinion, I'm not sure if it's right, that's where I want your perspective. It looks like these investors want to take out all their money as quickly as possible. Okay, so they're just forcing these acquisitions to happen. So the problem with these consolidations is none of them have been successful in the semiconductor industry. Most of them, I would say. I wouldn't call it none of them. Most of them in the integration issues. It's you can project it. To the market, you can project it that you have this much growth, this much of synergies and all that. But 2-3 years down the line, when all of this has happened and settled, because I know what happened with Freescale. I come from Freescale. There was a group called Blackstone, okay, which actually acquired it at 17 billion. An amount of debt, they never able to clear it. Okay, they again came back and did an IPO. And what happened, the general perception that I have, my opinion is, these investors are, it's like they're just bothered about their money. Okay. They're pushing all this consolidation to happen. 2-3 years down the line, those integrations are not going to work out as you would have expected them or as you have projected them.
So I see that uncertainty, as you say, because a lot of job losses are going to happen. Okay, and 2-3 years down the line, you would have realized that you didn't achieve what you set out to achieve. But the investors have already taken the money out. They know where to put the money next. So in this perspective, there is a lot of impact to a lot of people. So I just want to understand what would be a better way to handle this.
I can only comment, right, on this. I wish I had enough money to manage the consolidations and integrations, and I could push it, so I would have given a bit different perspective. But sorry, your name?
Satish.
So Satish, a very, very interesting point. Without trivializing what you said, this is happening in every sector. So I'll tell you, there are at least 4 things which are common, have been going on for several decades in the business. One is consolidation. We never had so many companies in the past, that's why we probably didn't see enough consolidation. Now we are seeing more, but as a phenomenon, it's been going on. Second is investors and the VC marketplace has always been like this. They only bother about their money. If you enter a VC company as an employee, the first checklist you're given is every single step, how you're making sure you're getting back your money plus X percentage. Okay, so that is their job. So I don't expect the investment community to go down any other path. They are not there for philanthropy. Okay, so let's get that.
No, but they created a value out of all this.
I'll talk to you about it. It's like real estate in Bangalore, right? Do you think ACS layout wants 10,000 rupees per square foot on a corner site? No. Its market valuation probably 4,500. Why is it in 10,000? That hoax gap is being built in the real estate community. So, sorry, I'm not denying your point. I just want to make sure we set some ground rules on at least the basic disciplines that happen. Third thing, there's a lot of cash moving in the overall global market. Okay? We didn't have this kind of flow, and it's continuously increasing. Despite regression, despite all the nonsense that we're going through, there's a lot of money going on. Okay? And a lot of people involved in, a lot of new entities coming in. So, I will give you an example. Today, corporate entities who have no idea about banking or lending are becoming what we call in this clearing participants. Okay? It's a fundamental role in the entire funding transaction. So think of it like your NSE and BSE that we have, right? It's an equivalent to that. It's not an exchange, but a semi-exchange. You have corporates who want to become that across the globe. That's why I said this phenomenon is happening everywhere, because I believe there's a lot of money, there's a lot of cross-border money that's flowing through. And the regulatory environment has been going up and down, up and down. It was up in the last decade. So regulatory environment was up in a few sectors like financial, because they were the most beaten. While other sectors were let go and there a lot of money flow through, consolidation happened. And it's going to continue to happen. Now we have Trump taking over US, we have Brexit coming in UK. Believe me, regulations are going to change. They're all talking about deregulating a lot of things, which means there will be a lot more money flow in the financial sector, a lot more scrutiny on the rest of the sectors. The market is again going to make it neutral. I'm just telling you, so just wait for a few months, you're going to see a reversal of this phenomenon. Okay, so this is a cycle that's happening. I wish I had my chance to show you. If you just chart back for the 4 decades last, right, this has been a true sinusoidal curve. Okay, now lastly, how can we affect this? I don't really think we can affect at an investment level. We can understand the reasons. If I were in your place and if I'm managing a product which is going through this cycle, and if I want to add on any kind of uncertainty, the things I would do, I think that's what Intel and other organizations are doing, is diversification. So, and on top of it, the fourth phenomenon I forgot to talk about is the whole disruption of all the new technology, right? We've always had startups and innovators. We've had one or two go up. We've had the internet boom. Now I think the phenomenon has really grown. The reason being, it's not just a bunch of startups who are really disrupting. I think the disruption is becoming a phenomenon within each organization. For all good and bad, a lot of us might not feel that we're really innovating, but I think that's gotten into our DNA a lot more than what we had a few decades ago. So coming back to that, that is adding on a lot of pressure to the core traditional companies. So you have to diversify. Only way I would look at it, right? So if I say I'm managing a product like, give me an example. You talk, what is your product?
it's about chips, ICs,
right?
Mobile,
so you're going through diversification,
yeah,
right? As part of your role, if you're really owning the product, that is the first step you have to do anyways to just protect your core. Second is you have to look at newer markets. If your older market is tamped down, you have to look at newer markets. Either you have to tear out by geography, either or you have to tear out by scaling up and down. If you have been looking only at a tier 1 customer base, you have to start looking at tier 2, tier 3. Or you have to start looking at a brand new customer base, which is very hard in telecom sector because you've already tapped out probably predominantly. Or you have to start affecting other sectors. Which means, is there a way telecom can affect something else, yeah, altogether, right? So I'm not answering your question, I'm really giving your perspective. I think there are these three or four fundamental forces which should always be there, right? As a product manager, I can always continuously look at this checklist of things, saying, what is my market doing? Can I adapt to it? Can I prevent it? Prevention is very hard to do, okay? Unless you're in a really influencing position. The best way is, how can we get to the flow? Can we think a few steps ahead? Can I know what I can tell my customer which he doesn't know? That's a question which I ask all of my team to always think of. It can be at the smallest level of, can I add a field to the screen, all the way to, you know, can I introduce a brand new product? Is there something which I can tell my customer beyond what he or she knows? And that is why the whole data analytics is taking a big, big role now. I know you're talking at a macro level, I'm going back to a micro level of, as an individual, what can I do? These are few things which we can control in our organization, right? In our own roles, and we should continue to do that. From an investor perspective, I see this pressure on making money, margins, only continue to increase till we have some deregulation. And when deregulation happens, another set of problems will come, which will not be so much about controlling the purse strings, it will be more about pushing for growth. And, sorry, go on.
Basically, I have two questions. The first question is, when Rahul introduced you, you were a path-breaking person in starting the product management function in India. So what are the challenges that you faced and how did you overcome that? That's the first question. The second question is, what are the top three pitfalls that you want the product manager to avoid when in a person like us? What you said is, you want your team members to have these 10 points. But I'm unable to tie it and understand in these two perspectives, that, you know, how do you overcome the challenge of starting a product management function? Secondly, what are the pitfalls that we need to avoid?
Okay. What I was talking about it from macro sense. So yeah, we have to answer that. So let's, I'll give you context so that you know exactly where I come from, right? Instead of giving you a 10,000 foot level answer. So the interesting things about us starting product management function here is two things. One is, as an organization, Broadridge has predominantly had product management only focused on the sales part of it, okay? Only in the recent past, over the last decade or so, we have focused on a holistic function. I think that is where, you know, I kind of got in. Second is, for the first time, we were doing product management remotely, which is from India. So which means it's not product management just being done as an auxiliary arm to somebody sitting in the States or anywhere, wherever your headquarters is, but really driving it from here. I think those are the two things you need to have in context. Not many of us may be in the same place, but I'll talk to you about it from there.
Can you add an example?
Of?
When you said product management being driven out of India, right? And you own it.
Yeah.
Is an example? Because we are not from a financial background. Any one particular example?
Example of a product or example of
product,
a role itself?
Product which you are managing.
Oh, sure. Broadridge, Broadridge has predominantly been developing software products. So software products are products that think of them as engines which are behind any of your banks and broker dealers. Pick any name, right? But typically our customer base has been predominantly the global dealers, not so much local on India, but predominantly global market players. So if you put in a trade, a buy or a sell transaction, after that whatever happens, everything happens in a product change. Okay? So that's what I would call as a product. So it's fairly huge. That's why I was taking a minute to define it to this context. Because if I were to tell the way we define that in the marketplace is product solutions help you manage your entire post-trade processing with any customer, on any instrument, on any market, with any entity. That's how we define it. It's a global product management solution. So that's a product that I'm speaking of amongst many. And the last 3 years have been a more intense journey where we have built a true product management function from India. And I was telling Rahul, we recently launched about 2 years ago a new solution in this space. And within the second year, we have about $32 million business already running. So very, very aggressive sales pipe. Extremely interesting set of clients. But back-end and execution factory is really trying hard to catch up. So that's the context for you. Okay. Now I'll talk about the challenges in setting up a function like this. Banking sector today continues to be a traditional Caucasian, white male, 50-year-old sector. Okay, let me be very, very open about it. You don't have too many Asians, too many women, too many youngsters driving the strategy on product. Still the same set of 50-year-old white males who found the company. I think we still have several sectors which this continues, okay? That was the first thing which you have to encounter. The first time you enter a room talking about what your product strategy is, question is how credible are you? What, do you even know what you're talking about? If I go in as a McKinsey consultant or a Boston consulting group, I'm given a different treatment because they still look at me as, okay, it's part of consulting, you know, I have enough good data, research reports, PowerPoints to show and talk. But when I go on and say, this is what I think is a product roadmap, this is how you should be driving a strategy, and this is what I'm asking for investment. The first question, either frankly told in front of you or talked behind you is, do you even know what you're talking about? Okay, so that's the first thing. So it's so much a softer aspect rather than a harder aspect. It's not that you can avoid it by taking a few classes. Second, India predominantly has been a back-end factory. Any sector, right? Only now we speak of, you know, being in the front. Even India origin organizations, we still continue to look at our clients abroad and expect them to give us direction. We don't really drive it. We have obviously several sectors now coming up with a lot more innovation. But if you look at overall software sector, if you look at, sure.
If you see any sector where India is actually following instructions from the Western world, is it not because the Western world, Western companies, or companies in the Western world are already in the ahead of the technology?
It's possible, yes. But yeah, that's true. That's precisely why we also have been fairly diligently following, right? Because we believe they know better than us, right? Yeah. But how long has it been? No, I'm just giving, he was asking about what are the roadblocks for me to set up a function, right? So one of them was this, that do you even know what you're talking about, because we have been doing this for the last 20 years. Second is, we still control the purse strings and we know how to manage money, do you know? You guys are just helping us, right?
No.
The third, the reason your context is important, but it's not the only driving factor. Just because somebody has been doing something for 2 decades does not mean somebody would know more. That's where the whole millennial generation, the user base change that has happened, the diversification in technology is coming, which really plays for us as India compared to what's we see in the West.
Okay.
And it's important, sorry, I'm not cutting you. It's important that we drive that notion that it has to be a collaborative path. And it's not a matter of, you know, I'm not being patriotic here. This is the way forward. Without taking the millennial generation together, and that can only happen from some of the economies like India, no way can any organization move forward just having a think tank sitting in the West. This is reality. Okay. Sorry, go ahead.
So my question was, see, I'm an entrepreneur. So basically, when we work on ideas and then say this is a fantastic idea to work on,
yeah,
what essentially happens is someone has already implemented in US. That's what happens.
Mm-hmm.
And those ideas which we think are not there anyway in the market, the target market happens to be somewhere in the Western countries.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, like Pramit Soni recently started a BI tool.
Mm-hmm.
And he's based out of Silicon Valley because
mm-hmm.
that's where the acceptance of new technology happens.
Mm-hmm.
So and that has been, and then I don't know how will it essentially change. like if you look at all the big names in Indian entrepreneurhood, it is always it's a technology, it is ahead of the technology only if it is targeted at the Western world.
I have absolutely no problems with that. I think we have to go where the money is, where the customer is. If the customer is sitting in Honolulu, I would go there, okay? That was not my point. My point was, can we do that from here? Okay,
yeah.
In your case, it's a little different because you are really doing it anyway on your own. You're probably a few steps ahead of us, right? But in a traditional organization, this is something which is fairly difficult. If you have been part of a multinational organization, you would know what I'm talking to. I see some nods of the heads. So the third thing is...
it actually makes a lot of sense to me because I work for the electronics. And I'm trying to bring in a product function in the company. And I'm facing the similar issue that you are accredited controlling the first thing. So it's December month, so I can definitely get that.
Yeah, I mean, start planning right now. So. thank you. But your point is very important. The ecosystem will always be where the money is, right? I don't think we should even touch that, okay? As long as India can make more money than that, why not?
Yeah.
Or else we should go for West, why not? I think the problem I was talking about is slightly different. In a preset sector, how do you establish a function? Which is a little different. So pitfalls to avoid? I think the credibility issue, the way I try to solve, okay, personal credibility is different, right? That only comes in once you show one of the success stories. And you do it when everybody has told you it's you give up. I don't think there's any other way for that, okay? At least in my, I've done this, this is the probably third time that I'm doing a different thing in my career. Every time it has been, take an extremely hard use case, people have been talking about for decades and not solved for, just sat on it on their behinds. And you do it faster, cheaper, show the result. That's the only way. It will hit a lot of people badly on their face. I think we have to be in people's faces. That's the first thing I talk to my team as part of their induction. That's the first thing as India we have to learn as a skill. I know this generation we are far more aggressive, but take a generation before, we are always about, okay, you tell us, do you think this is right? We take more consensus and approvals than do the work, right? Sorry.
As an Indian, if you see our culture from childhood, from our education system, our social situation, we follow children's order.
Yes.
We follow
yes,
them. We feel okay, they know better than us.
That's right.
Okay. So absolutely, this is not going to change in a day or two. It will take maybe decades more. This is first thing. How do we really bring in change in this mindset? It's all about mindset.
Right.
How do we bring this change? How you were able to bring this change? Okay. The second question is, when we are developing locally and when we are thinking globally, every part of the world is different. Every customer base is different. The cultural traits are different. The needs are different. The expressions are different. So sitting here in India, how do we really get to know this cultural aspect and the needs, and how do we really bring in that those every element of that culture or the expectation needs into the product what you're developing sitting here? How are we able to do that?
So few things. Thank you for joining us.
Sure.
So few things, right? One is, I don't think this can be taught in class again. Sorry, I'm telling you so many things we can't teach in a class, right? So, this is what I have learned.
Why I'm saying it? Because I come from Shine Electric. I'm basically working in Shine Electric. And we are trying very hard to build a product management setup here.
Okay.
Building some ownership offers from the products which can work for global market also.
Okay.
And we are finding very difficult to take this product globally.
Mm-hmm.
Because all such kind of questions are being asked. And our team itself take little one step back. Despite they are technically very sound, they can bring a lot of innovations, but when it comes to deal with the global clients or global partners, this mindset plays a because of this mindset we are taking much.
You brought a fantastic point, sir. What's your name?
Gautam,
fantastic point. Believe me, every single day I am still going through that even after several decades. So let me talk to you about it. I don't know if I can answer the question. I'll talk to you on how I think about it and how we as a team are looking at it, right? I don't think culturally we are wrong listening to elders. We should. But it's about defining what is an elder, right? So it goes back to his point. Somebody is controlling your purse string. Does that make him right always? No. It makes him an influencer, him or her. I would like to talk about her, but I see very few hers in the room. So influencer. So now let's come back. Right? Let's take a simple conversation. One is, what is the culture in your organization? Every organization goes through different. Probably 10-15 years ago, most of the captains had three adjectives defined, right? If you are a committed person, committed, dedicated, loyal, think of yourself like Ekalavya, right? And that used to be like a hero. You are here 24 hours doing everything, whatever you've been told, and you're thinking of adding value without asking for more money. That was actually applauded as a quality. That is called as being a loser in the West. Why? Because their time is money. Because their people are precious. We are not a commodity. So the first thing we have to think of, whether my idea is bad, I want to use a stronger word, but I don't want to. Or whether my idea is good, I should have the belief and self-respect to go and stand in front of anybody and talk about it. I think as an organ, as a community, we lack that. It's not about Japan has a similar culture. Why is that Japanese people are heard? Chinese, they have the same culture. Why are they heard? They still have the joint family culture. Why are they heard? How have we been doing that? The reason I believe it's culture is definitely important. Learning culture is also important, but I don't think you can learn culture by sitting in a certain place. We are what we are because we grew up in a certain way. Okay? I mean, we might stay in the States or Canada or Hong Kong for 20 years. Even then, we probably pick up a few practices, but inherently, we will be what we are. Okay? So that's why I don't think it is practical to talk of changing culture. And I don't think it's practical to talk of learning 2000 cultures that's out there in the marketplace. Okay? Let's come back and define what are the key dimensions. You are selling a product. There is a buyer. Do you know your buyer? Okay? You can't know a buyer sitting there if you are selling for somebody in Hawaii. And the same problem exists even for a guy who's sitting in the US. Okay? He doesn't know, if he has to sell to India, he won't know what Indian wants. Okay? So it doesn't matter whether you are Indian, whether you are somebody else. If from Schneider you want to do a product for somewhere there, you need to have a team, a frontline team who should be sitting in the marketplace whom you are selling to, understand the user characteristics, come back and develop. Unfortunately, that's a reality. It's not. Culture is important. I'm not trying to trivialize your question, but this is something I've gone through day in and day out. I'm telling you, we have to get to that aspect where we can say, this is the product, this is the value proposition. As India, are we mature enough to talk of value proposition of a product? Do we even know what we call as value? We don't. That is where the problem is. When you start talking in the same language as the other person, culture, race, gender, everything falls off. And I've seen this in action every single day. Okay? Sorry, go on.
Talking about value proposition, there has to be a lot of focus. At least that's how I see it. You talked about diversification, but how important is focus? For example, Paytm, when it started, it was just a wallet and it was perfect. Today it's an everything store. It's trying to be an Amazon. And I don't know what Paytm is anymore. So how focused we must be, because when we know about our focus, then we can talk about value proposition.
That's a fantastic point. This is a topic you and I can debate for a long time. I can tell you every single thing that goes on, and I'm sure I have a counter because.
Of course, this is one of the.
So we should talk more if you need. I don't want to just let go of it, but I'll take your question. Your name, please.
Khan. I come from a UX background, so.
Excellent.
It's pretty much living with the customer, right?
I mean, fantastic. You are my dream product manager. So believe me. This is what I tell my users. Whether you're designing a database, you're designing a solution, everything has a UX. Okay, so your question was diversification versus focus. I think the question itself has to be changed. Okay. I'm sorry if I'm coming across as arrogant and trying to change your questions or perspectives, but I'm trying to give you reality, right?
I wish our managers were like this.
Thank you. Because it's the first thing I think we all have to learn. 10 years ago, I was not like this. So this is what I have learned, okay? So let's start with your question. I think the question has to be changed. The reason is you can never have one or the other. What I mean by that, right? It is like, let me simplify by that as an example. Let's say, a day in the life of anybody, forget product manager, anybody who's doing any decent job, you will have at least 50 minutes to do, correct? But scientifically, it has been proven that the brain can only do one. You can never do multiple things, okay? The only way we are doing it is we are just reducing the time slice, correct? So that's a fundamental philosophy. Same thing applies everywhere. A person, a product, at home, if you are talking to your child, you can only talk to the child. You can't be doing cooking and you can't be talking. No, it's only that. So that brings back to the whole concept of mindfulness and culture. I don't want to go down that path, but that's very important. Now let's come back to product strategy, right? Focus versus diversify. So we should not call it as versus. So your every product strategy plan has to look at what is my protect the core strategy, what is my core. The core will always remain the core. Then you have a diversification strategy. You have to continuously look at both. It's like a pendulum. You cannot take your eye off the ball of either. Focus is important on what you are doing, but if you only do that, you only remain there. And two things can happen. Either you are taken away by somebody else who comes in who does it better, cheaper, faster, younger, and probably better looking. While it's important in this marketplace, right? Or the other way is somebody else will come in and probably scrap this whole marketplace because they do something else altogether different. So there is no way you can do only one. Okay. Now let's translate that back to a young product manager who is entering a function, right? If you talk about this level, he's going to get confused and quit the next day. So your job as a manager of the product managers would be defining what is the product for. That's where the whole product roadmap becomes extremely critical. When you're defining your roadmap, you have to continuously keep your eye on the ball of what your current client commitments are, because they are the ones who are paying you money, okay? Let's remember that. Then, in every release of yours, a simple technique, right? I use the 70-20-10 technique in my feature. 70% of it is typically what I need for my customers to do. 20% is what I call as delighting the same customers. 10% is what I call as, you know, what would be long term. Tomorrow that long term ball might keep changing, which means that 10% might be a continuous investment from me and it may get scrapped. That's fine. So this ratio keeps wavering, but that's how we have to define to each of our product managers to look at your backlog, your roadmap, your checklist to ensure continuously on both sides. So you can't, Paytm example was slightly different. I mean, I can't define or I can't comment on why Paytm is doing it. I'm sure they have a good enough plan. But just coming back to the fundamental question of can you just do what you're supposed to do versus looking at other things, I don't think we can let go of either. He has an example.
Yeah.
We can finish that. How are you doing on time? When I start talking, generally, I go 5 times.
Yeah, I have 30 minutes.
Good.
Okay. So just because of the way you aligned it, right? I really kind of aligned well with what Synopsis does. I think Sankarshana might correlate back to what Synopsis does for a long time, right? So we were an EDA company focusing on all our customers were traditional customers in the mobile space, processor space, and all that, right? So the mind. So that is how it works.
Yeah. Thank you.
Sorry, but this is bad. So the focus is still the core of all the products we have, traditionally we have had, is to protect that business, right? Because that is still there, it's a big chunk of money for us and we still put it. But where the diversification happened, even in that context, was the automotive thing, right? Everybody today is slowly getting into the automotive space. That means our products have to go through one more layer of certification to be used there. Now you can manage it as a product which, like how you've done before, or you can start looking at this context and see what we can do with these products
which is all our butter and butter, because a very big chunk. And now what do we do with this, right? So that is one part of diversification which we have to manage. Now, having said this, this is with our core products, right? And slowly we have been acquiring a lot of companies now, which has helped us go into the security space. Now, when you talk about security, it's a huge opportunity out there, which we don't know what we're doing. At least one thing which we seem to be clear after 2 years of getting into this is that there we see that there is good money to be made in automation and industrial sector. But one thing which is not explored yet, as far as I know, is the banking part. So 2 years down
not
the line,
they're not competitive.
2 years down the line, I am hoping or I believe this, we will have a lot of folks like on the financial side who will be our customers. Now, if somebody was worked in the core sector all this time, if he was stayed in Synopsis for 20 years, and he moves on to this new side of the business and starts working with customers on the financial side, how will we really do this? Right. Does it rhyme with what she said? Because this is how I felt when I heard this. It's so true to what's happening in Synopsis.
It's a very common phenomenon. I think I get your question.
Can I take examples of everybody knows why. You're coming from the financial side, right? I have been a customer to a bank for the last 2 decades. Suddenly, I had a demat account with that company. I had mutual funds with the same company. I have a banking account with the same company. But now suddenly there is a Zerodha, which is a lot more better in terms of user experience and is absolutely focused in what it is doing. And it keeps me so clinged to that particular, the way they are doing the business, that it didn't take much to take away a 20-year-old customer into it. And Scriptbox, I mean, completely automated, robotic way of figuring out mutual funds. And I can go with 5,000 to 1,000 to 20,000 to whatever, right? And today, these two focused companies have taken a customer who is inbuilt into an ecosystem into theirs. I mean, this is happening with almost every part of our life. And that is where, as a product manager, should we be pushing on being focused and doing that very well? Because I think if we do one thing, it would take one lifetime. I mean, in the sense, you can be so...
I completely agree.
In a way, they lost a customer to two others, right? I mean...
Think of it this way also, right? The banks are not doing their job. It's not just that, you know, these guys are doing a better job.
That's what happens if you lose focus. You can't do everything.
Yeah, it's a very philosophical debate on what we define as focus. But let's think of it, right? If Amazon was doing only what it was doing, selling books for these many years, would it have made sense? If Apple was only doing whatever iPod or whatever was its first product, would it have gone up this much? So that's why I love philosophical debates, but I'm telling you in a practical reality, if you've gone through Michael Porter's Forces of, you would see, I mean, there are several books out there, philosophies. I don't think we can afford to just stay in one space, but I'll tell you what disclaimers. Whatever Scriptbox is doing is still not staying in one space. They are doing what they're doing very much better, and they're adding value which is intangible to you, you're not even seeing it. On the other hand, probably your DMAT accounts in ICICI Bank, etc. are doing a lousy job. Okay? So as a product manager, that's why I said protect the core strategy is how I define it. Protect the core does not mean I do the same thing 5 to 20 years. Protect the core means I ensure all my competitors are at bay. So if you call that as focus, that's very much a part of our job. But I'm saying that cannot be 100%. It has to be a 60-70% based on the market. You have to have your eye on the ball of what's happening in the market. I'll give you an example on financial marketplace, right? So we've had our markets called derivatives. I would really appreciate if you keep the phones down, please. I understand all of us, believe me, I have the same habit. So let me go back. Okay, derivatives marketplace, right? So derivatives, if for few folks who understand, it's their futures and options, and it's pretty much
it's not tangible. You are just selling and buying a concept there, okay? You are assuming that gold will go down because of demonetization and you are buying a gold, okay? And to hedge it, you are buying an option to buy back at a particular price. So this is the simplest example of a derivative. There are other options where you are saying you have instruments being delivered which are like airline bonds. So you have Boeing Airlines, which Boeing has a business plan. It knows this is the my order book for the next several years. And this is how I'm looking at it based on inflation, blah, 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 blah. I have this is my pipeline. And Boeing knows this is for building. This is if I lease it. And this is assuming that all the regulations for certification still remain the same. This is how, let's put it as, okay. Based on that, an investment bank comes in. They actually take out a bond, assuming the airline sector is going to go up and down for something. Your leasing revenue will be like this. Your building expense will be like this. Such an exotic instrument. Think of it. Who would buy an airline bond? I wouldn't even know. I'm flying every single day. I'm flying Boeing or Airbus or whatever. Okay. Right? So, and you have to create a market for this. So this is the kind of exotic products that were coming in. 2008, everything gone bust. All exotics were just went down. People had trillions of dollars, and the way we are seeing crores of 500 rupee notes being burnt and sold in Ganga Yamuna, this is what happened in 2008 for dollars. People didn't even know where the money was, right? The market went down. If I was doing the same thing what I was doing, this is what happened. Company like MF Global, one of the biggest firms in the street, just went bankrupt on day zero. There was not even a single buyer out there to buy it at a penny. Okay, I'm just taking it in my sector. MF Global was one of the pioneer players. Look at Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs, I don't know what they're doing. They're always considered as the smartest in terms of both technology and strategy in Wall Street, okay? Goldman Sachs survived, and they actually made a better quarter despite all the crush. So what were these two doing differently? They were both doing their business very well. Not that Goldman would know that, you know, Lehman is going to crash and everything is going to come down. They might have had their risk analysts look at whatever they had to do. But there was a clear focus on protect the core and what's going on in the market. Goldman had already spun off a venture which called as, we have a concept of proprietary trading. Proprietary trading, in simple example, is let's say I'm trading with Professor Rahul and I'm buying, he's selling, that's it, done. This is, I'm buying on my behalf, I'm making money. For example, I'm buying on behalf of Gautam. So then I become the broker. Gautam is a customer, I'm the broker. So I buy on behalf of him, I sell on behalf of him, and all I'm making is commission, I'm not making profit. So I don't hold anything in my books. Okay? This is a simple example of agency versus proprietary trading. Goldman did a very smart thing. It took their proprietary trading entity, created it as a new entity, put it in a different marketplace, because they were seeing something going on in the US. They diversified it to look at Asian market. A lot more proprietary trading happening there. Derivatives was a far more protected marketplace. For example, India derivatives market didn't get affected that much. It survived. So do you call this as focus or do you call this as diversification? I call this as protect the core. That's why I said let's change the question. Okay? So I'll move on from the topic. I think he had a question. Just one second. Bindu, if you can give me a last 10-minute alert, I want to just round up so that we don't get people.
Sure. How you are influencing your actual management is in the other side of
yes.
the country, you know, or in the western side. How you are influencing your strategy for the your management?
Okay.
And also you have to be...
My management here or there?
There.
Okay.
But your actual management, I don't know whether here or there. And you are all customers...
I'll tell you the difference.
Okay. But all your customers are again from the other part of the world, in the western side.
Okay.
How you are taking input and how you are making them again, making them to follow the your strategy.
Okay, sure. They won't follow, by the way. We have to use samadana, danda, veda, everything. So if people don't know what it is, I'll tell you. So the first thing is, we have to be where the customer is. That's why, you know, Rahul talked of my travel and etc. Each product manager has to be where the customer is. You can't sit here and say, okay, I will sit here in Bangalore in the ACS layout and I will do everything. No, it won't work. Even in the most virtually enhanced work, it will not work, okay? Because in person is where I can influence. The same session, if I had done it on the phone, on a conference call, even with video conference, how many of you would have even stayed? Probably half the class would have gone up and went down, right? So you cannot influence without being in person. Unfortunately, that's a human psyche. I don't know when it will change, I'm not sure. That's one. Second part is, you had several questions, okay? Let's start with one. So you talked about management. There are two things, right? You have global organizations, most of Indian firms, software firms at least, are captives. Then your senior management or executive management is really sitting in the West or somewhere else, and you are really, call it partnering, but you're really following their orders. That is one setup. That's where my setup was, okay? Second setup is where we have firms here, Tata and Infosys, where we are controlling, but we are still service providers. Our customers are in the West, so we still have to have directions from West. The third sector is entrepreneurs. For us, nobody is there. We are the owners, we are everything. We will just buy and sell as long as somebody is there to buy. So I will leave the third sector out because your question is probably whether we can do, right? So first is, it's very important to distinguish what I call as my management here and my management there. Reason I am saying it is, today I am part of the management, but a lot of us in the room might be still looking for directions and influence from our senior management team sitting here before we even get there. Is that right? Yes? No? Right? How many of you are getting the right level of support that you think you need from our management here?
Not getting.
No, right? The reason is, I understand. There is this still mentality of we are service providers, which is why I think I understood your comment as wish my managers were like this. I understand what you're saying, because there are a lot of folks, we still believe that we have to protect our core, which means my job is this, my boundary is this, before we get on to the next level, before we jeopardize the whole franchise because one person has a great idea, and if I support that idea, the rest of the relationships are going to go. If that support you don't have, you're going to be in trouble. That's the first thing you have to garner. Whoever is your management, okay?
I think it has a lot to do with it has a lot to do with the social security also. If I see the social security in European countries, their job is secured. Okay, that means if they lose a job, the government has support them for some time.
That's true.
If you lose a job, okay, I don't know what will happen to my family. And maybe that is the reason we are trying to first try to secure our basics. And then,
no, I have no issues with that.
What stops us to have or challenge the mindset or bring the change in the mindset? So there are a lot of things has to do with the social.
I agree. Believe me, socially, economically, as a country, as a society.
So my question again was the same thing.
Okay.
How do we bring change in that? What could be done differently so that we bring in change in that? I'm again looking from how do we think.
We have to think, let me get this question and come back to you, because I think this is something which has to happen at a macro level. I know ecosystem wise, at an India level, we're bringing in a lot of changes, good or bad. We're in an experimental mode. Think of demonetization, I would not have dreamt of it. So I believe it's good or bad, it's a step in the right direction.
At our level, how do we start?
So our level, the first thing we have to do is stand up for ourselves. Okay, now let's talk about the management. So coming to your question, right? So the first thing is you have to garner your support. And if you want to push your idea, you have to be like an entrepreneur in your own organization. Do you have enough belief in your idea? If you want to set up, it's not going to be easy. After a certain time, you might feel that the organization DNA at all is not there for that. Then you're probably hitting against the wrong wall. So, that kind of maturity we need to have. And at the same time, we need to have the perseverance of doggedly going behind it. I'm sorry, there is no other shortcut for it. Okay, that's one. Second, influencing the Western part of management. All good and bad, right? You always look at East versus West. My experience over the last 20 years has been with the West, predominantly. My work class is always in the evening and the night, much to my chagrin of my husband. But knowing West, I mean, Rahul, you correct me if I'm wrong, it all comes down to results, right? You show 3 successful proof of concepts. I'm making it very simple, like, to answer to your question. Show 3 successful proofs of concepts. Talk about a game plan which next 6 months is what I'm going to do. I think there will be a lot more acceptance for that, or at least an open mind about trying that compared to I want to change the world and give me a $50 million. I know these are two extremes, but I'm saying for me it's always worked to have a success story to show, to understand the customer and not go there with half-baked knowledge. If we do that, there is a lot more acceptance to at least doors opening for a conversation. It will not be a yes, I will sign you a check in the first meeting. I think that that's the first way. I mean, we've always done this every single time it has worked. Know your customer. As India entity, we have a tremendous power. We have technology in our hands. Most of the execution is happening here. We have the engineering power. We have to be able to mine the data, mine the insights we are getting. We probably have a customer service function sitting here. They may be only picking up calls and talking help desk, fine. But even then, you're getting very rare customer insights. Do we know enough to develop that? So there are ways based on each situation. I strongly believe that if there is a way we can show results, it's very hard to say no to a money-making idea. Okay. So I'll stop at that because there's several other questions. Anything else you want to touch upon? Does this make sense? Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to come back to that point where you said you have mainframe systems working for 55 years. So how do you penetrate into the market, into IoTs and cloud and all that? Because, you know, if you change one bit of code, you'll have the entire system crashing.
Oh, yeah.
Down.
So, lovely question. Can I answer?
Yes.
Or somebody else has a question, can they take this? Yeah. So, okay, this is what is happening. It's not that we have just a student mainframe. Yeah.
Adding to her question, adding to her consultant, you have to give all your recommendations in terms of the newer, but the bank says, I have everything in mainframe. If you could answer that along with
this. Doing this every day. If you had asked me this question in the beginning, probably I would have spent 2 hours talking about it. So, obviously, we have not stopped at what we were doing, right? It's mainframes is still the core. There are several aspects to it. So, let's look at a few things. One is you have the core processing which happens, which goes on the mainframe. And we believe that mainframe is still the best source in terms of accuracy, dependability, efficiency. I don't think, I mean, we've had probably every possible technology solution marked against it, and we know that's. So our fundamental philosophy continues to be that mainframe is at the heart of it, which means you strip away all the peripherals of your processing steps. So I'm oversimplifying it, okay? So but let's say you take a trade processing, it has about 52 functions. So in 52 functions, I know that core settlements, core positions management, and core general ledger, these three have to be sitting there because every single second you are looking at the data to calculate your P&L, to calculate your accounts, to ensure your trading goes on. I do not want to touch them. So what we have done over the last several years, we have stripped out all the rest of the steps continuously and made it an incremental strategy rather than a big plan. That's one part. Second part is, I spoke of uncertainty, right? Several of those things. Cost pressures, it's getting to the clients too. They understand running a mainframe, IBM is not going to give you a discount anymore. Okay, so you have to have a cost proposition solution. So the cost pressure coming onto the clients are helping us because we can think of better solutions. That's one. The third factor is scope of digital transformation. Even on the client side, the influencer community is changing. That is the reason you see the speed picking up now compared to 10 years ago. 10 years ago, the influencers were still, you know, in the same philosophy of what they were when they started off as a, you know, a clerk or something in the organization. But now they're forced to change because their investors are changing. The retail investors are becoming a 20-year-old who's getting enough money, who can start trading, and he wants to have everything in an app, in a mobile technology. You can't expect him to go to a green screen and put in a trade, right? That is influencing, digital transformation. Fourth thing, I think we spoke of the whole growth part of it, that's getting to our clients too. So it makes a very, very strong story for us to continuously push for it. But obviously our roti kapda makan has to remain, which means you cannot lose a single trade, I cannot lose connectivity to any of my market entities, I cannot at any point in time stall the trading. In fact, what happens is our solutions, we get audited by the Federal Reserve, we get audited by every single regulatory entity. That doesn't happen for any software either. they audit the banks, but they audit us because they know if we crash, the market is going to crash. So we have that fundamental constraint that we have to continue to work towards, which is also our biggest strength. But the other factors are really pushing us to the newer journey. Does that answer your question? Last question, I guess.
Good evening, I'm Nitish Gulati.
Sorry, I couldn't wait.
I'm Nitish Gulati. I have two questions. So I'm glad Scriptbox came out because I'm part of the product consultancy startup that built Scriptbox from scratch.
Excellent.
Now, I've seen Scriptbox, which has scaled to 160 crores of revenue and stuff like that. And we've also worked with other clients in the mutual fund sector who are pretty new in the space. We see restrictions in terms of, like you mentioned, you know, how does a product manager work in enterprise scenarios where you have a mainframe? So that's also happening in the mutual fund space. You have a lot of features which you can print out to users, but they're not really stable because they're all built by third-party companies, some other vendors. So as a product manager, what would your perspective be? Should we take the risk of taking that unstable technology and going to market with it?
No.
Or
I'm telling you the answer right now. See, okay, that's
so
why.
The reason I'm asking this is because probably even my answer would be no, but
no,
sometimes the senior management can be really pushy about it.
Wow, I love that senior management. So, so this is where I think, right? I guess again, no is also what depends, correct? So let's look at a couple of things. I understand where senior management and others might be coming in, probably from a cost perspective, economic standpoint, and speed and time to market. All these factors there, no? All the wonderful things that we have in a project. But as an idealist, obviously you don't want to go with something which doesn't work to the market. Now, let's see, that is where we have all the nice things like doing a beta, doing a prototype, going with the customers, partnering with the customers. In a B2B scenario, you have to partner with the investors, which can be a pain in different parts of the body. While in B2C, there is a lot more tools where you can do, you know, a prototyping. Do it, do a focus group, figure out. I think we cannot afford to always wait for the technology to be completely stable. That's what we all push our engineers to do. Do it faster, cheaper, and give it to me right now. So the simple answer can't be no, but you have to define the parameters of instability, and you have to exactly know what the messaging has to be. Okay? Better have your messaging right. You should know what you're telling your customers. You can't tell this a working provision that you can. If you're affecting the customer's business, you're out of your job. Okay? Or you should consider out of your job. The reason is, when you are doing something for the longevity perspective, you have different techniques to do. Even customers are interested in innovative solutions. That doesn't mean you're affecting your consumers. So I think that's a fundamental golden rule you can't really break, okay? There are ways around it, several ways around it. I don't think it has to be yes or no answer.
The second question. You talked about building credibility.
Hmm.
Now, somebody also mentioned that that sort of expectations of working in an enterprise environment cannot be from a 2-year-old product manager.
No,
I personally have only fears of working.
No worries. Okay.
And in terms of building credibility, I run my own website and blog on product management.
Fantastic.
What other options or avenues can we explore in terms of building credibility?
Building credibility where becomes the next question, right? So, by the way, I am a huge fan of bringing on people fresh from college and putting them in product management. Okay, in my organization, I have been vandalized almost for doing that, but I've been doing it. So let me tell you the composition of my team just to give you context, right? I have global teams across India in two locations, states, and London and Prague, and some in Russia, and we've acquired a new company which has been Ukraine. Okay, imagine the composition. So out of this, predominantly from India, almost 40 to 45% are fresh grads. Believe me, it did not help me in building credibility when I went with this composition to my management. But I believe that's a huge way to bring in new talent. The reason being that it's a fresh mind. I believe I still have the power to influence that. Maybe not so much with the rest of the crowd. But more importantly, the product management job is also about energy and perseverance and curiosity, right? Which we tend to lose over certain times. So, okay, that's on the talent part of it. Your question was building credibility for a young product manager, right? So I think there is no way that you can get away from not loving something about your technology, not learning something about your business and something about your customer. So unless these three are covered, which you cannot learn in 1 year, 2 years, I understand, to continuously learn. Because you cannot get away by saying, I did 3 years, so I'm a product manager, no, sorry. So yeah, even after 20 years, I'm still learning my customers. I'm going into a Middle East market, Islamic market. I don't have a single clue of what Islamic market rules are, Sharia laws are, but I have to learn, okay? So we have to continuously learn about our customers. Now, second is building credibility. Like the reason I say this, it's both internal and external, where you're trying to build it. So are you building credibility with an external world, with a customer? Then you really at least need to know what you're building as a product. And you should talk in their language. So that's the simplest. If I'm talking to a telecom person, I should talk in telecom language. If I talk in my own banking language, I've lost credibility there. If you don't know your own product, forget anything else, you will not. That's the first. Second thing. Third thing is, we all have a tendency, because most of us come from an engineering technology type of background, we all have a tendency to talk of our product features more than what are the problems it's going to solve for you as a customer. I think a lot of us are changing, but it has that passion, oh, I built this product, so I have to talk about 100 things. I keep telling my team that you have to stop loving your voice lesser. Listen, a lot of us love to talk, including me, right? Just let us go, we just want to talk about that. That's not the problem. You listen to the person first. So, some of these things are far more softer aspects. Building credibility is a huge factor of communication skills and learning product. These are for me fundamental. The rest can be incremental. If you want to really make it 1x to 10x faster, I still believe as India, the power of technology and overall execution, nobody else has in the world today. Okay? And but really the 1x to 10x comes by understanding the users, and that is where we are still losing out when we build credibility to the West, because they believe they know the customers, we don't know. They believe we can't talk to the customers. So build a product team which can start talking to customers. If you can do that, that is the first step in credibility.
Is that we don't know customers of the US, or we don't know even customers of the US?
Mainly, we don't know any customers because we've never faced customers. Customers is not so much about learning the culture, right? Customers is about, are you able to convince me to buy your product?
So if
it's an art of selling.
If the products are for the Indian market,
ideally you should be good at it. That is what people believe. And to proof, comes back to proof. I don't think it's only about the best. They believe the whole customer management bit is a lacking skill in India. That is the popular belief across the globe, because we've always been on the execution side. It's just my view.
There is another point of view that, you know, we are not good at sales a lot.
Not necessarily. I believe Indians are fantastic at sales. Come on, look at the amount of jugaad we can do. You can sell anything and everything. There are people who are selling spots on the banking queue for day one, I mean 500 rupee notes, okay? Really? My driver tells me that his son goes and stands on behalf of some people and is making money by the hour.
Yeah.
I think we're fantastic at sales. The problem is, are we able to talk at that language when we're saying yes, sir? It all comes down to proving, sir. Can you show that you're selling? Inmobi. Who can talk against Inmobi? So in India still, who is doing selling there? Not some Western guy coming and selling, no? So I think it comes down to belief and conviction. I know there's a lot we should do around it. My point is that core belief itself is missing in a lot of us. We all still believe we have to improve. We are not good at what we do. We have to better.
I do believe that. You say that we need to build a credibility, right? I'm from healthcare IT sector. Having said that, I'm also.
I think it's one of the most progressive sectors, at least from technology standpoint.
Absolutely. So, the other challenge is, you know, in my company, I'm trying to at least get to this notion of, you know, understanding, make the leaders to understand why you can't have a product team in India. Exactly the same challenge probably would have faced some decade ago. So, I understand completely where you're from, how you're.
I'm so happy to
Now my challenge is to get that credibility on. So what I started doing is at least not to ask for approvals and, you know.
Fantastic. That is what I was talking.
Since I am an industry SME, so I keep telling them what to do. So now they look at me as an SME rather than somebody who's taking orders, you know. So that's the kind of thing I have been able to do it. Now the next step is how do I make that workable and get things, you know, our way.
Yeah. So yeah, I know exactly because I was here probably like 7-8 years ago where I did all the selling. Now my sales pipe was enough. People were all gung-ho, you know, I want, now I need a team who can actually execute it. So I hear you. I think it's then comes back to product governance, but you know, some of the things which we were speaking earlier. How do you get that going?
So my question probably to you is, how do I get my leadership to believe in that this can be done? When I spoke to them, when I speak to them, they say it is not a priority. Then I have many other buckets in my, you know, I want.
Is there a way you can tie it back to
the
business? Unfortunately, everything goes back to the KPIs, right? So sometimes, a lot of times our entire unit KPIs are so much around delivery,
yes.
We don't even have a KPI which focuses on business. That's the first thing we started doing, okay?
That's the problem with me, you know, but I mean, my company, we are the manager,
yeah.
We delivery manager, so I, when I want to talk to my MD, MD doesn't have time. So that's why I want to try, but then
I have techniques which I don't want to talk in public forum because I always grow break rules, right?
No, I did for this next month. This month probably industry community is coming and talking here, so I have some time. So,
yeah.
So
what I
do you have any techniques such please share it.
Techniques?
Yeah.
See,
no, because it's very, very useful because sometimes you know this it doesn't come in straight away.
Okay.
No, I think it's a very critical issue because everyone can relate to it, and you have to share my experience. It's like when we started doing work for the lead sites, okay, we were learning. 5 years down the line, we reached a stage where
you guys are sharing too many jokes, okay? I feel like a teacher asking you guys to stop. Huh.
So 5 years down the line, we actually reached a stage. The first stage we were learning.
Oh.
We reached a stage where we are able to propose our ideas. Okay, but we don't see the support of the management over here. Okay, it's like I share the idea and say it's good, it's fine, they don't execute it. The same idea comes from over there. It's the same thing. Okay, no change in words. Okay, they just take it as an order.
Wow.
This is something I think everyone would have.
So
this is 8 years ago.
We have done few things, okay?
Shalini, we can turn the camera recording off so you can.
I face the same problem. The problem what you see here, we don't know the art of selling.
No, it's not like that. It's
not
like that. It's again the risk factor that you're talking
about.
Our manager
is
not
raising
the risk.
Exactly.
Exactly.
It's a convincing factor. Because the same problem. 3 years back, we brought in a new idea, okay, which was completely discarded because I think we did not put it very properly. And the next last year, the same idea came and it was like, wow.
It's not about putting it out there.
So I'll tell you a few things we'll talk about.
The only thing that
because I can see the pain in the classroom. So I believe me, I can feel it. So it's not a joke.
Because the pain was so much that I had to tell him at the end of the year, okay, you want me to change the name for my color of the skin. I can't change the color of the skin. You want me to change the name so that you listen to what my change. That's the kind of pain. That is the kind of pain.
What was the answer?
There's no answer.
Good. I'm glad you said that. Okay. Sometimes, every single day, I think as leaders, we have to be in the face of people. That's why I said Samadhana Danda Veda, no? We have to use everything possible. Okay, I know we probably running out of time, but US.
Maybe we have to do a part two of this session.
Yeah,
point.
So I'll talk a couple of things, okay? One is, I think there are still these pet peeves when it comes to the different parts of the West, okay? Which goes back to your culture question, but not the nice part of culture of how to sit, how to eat and all that. Not this is a different kind of the culture aspect, which is US runs by Excel, okay? You give any CRAP, even if I'm recording, it's okay, in an Excel with nice formulae, 4 PowerPoint slides, with current state, future state, and action items and next steps, you have a lot of acceptance, okay? UK still follows divide and rule. So for them, you have a development function, you have a BA function, you have a QA function, you have a documentation function. They want to talk to each manager separately. They want to micromanage and they don't want you guys to talk to each other. In India, you better get that unity first. You have to talk to each other. You have to always have the same answer across all the groups. So whoever comes from there, have first your frontline army has to be one in your own team. Okay, so these are just a couple of things. This is what I call as cultural.
Can I add to that? Can I add Eastern Asian culture to that?
Sorry?
Yeah, I work for LG. So in the Eastern Asian culture, they play good, bad, good cop, bad cop very nice.
Yeah.
So your manager is always on fire.
Yeah.
So he'll always be the good cop. So the idea sharing which is said, it always comes to us. This our this year idea comes to us, next year has work from there, their idea. And it's always the project manager who fires us sharing that, you know, you guys don't even think. So you get pissed, you go to your manager, he says, yeah, some old next time.
So there are ways. Yeah, I mean, I don't think there is one way which can solve it in a single day, right? So I'm glad people are coming for me. First thing we need to do as managers, I don't expect the guys who have just joined to be corrupted with all this, right? It's like, I hate to tell my 4-year-old son some of these things that, you know, you don't have Santa Claus type of a thing. I don't want to do that to my product managers. Like, there will be an ideal world, build the right products. But as leaders, we have to know what is this in each of them. Come on, we are smart enough to break each one of them, okay? You just need unity on your own. That's number one. Number two is, we did a few things, right, from India standpoint. We again were, I can only talk about my journey and without knowing your context. So from our side, we had our development shop. We were even I come from development background, so we were developers. In fact, it was like an AS400 RPG technology. I don't know whatever you guys even heard of it, okay? This is what we did. And how do you build credibility being an RPG developer that is a product strategy, right? So it took step by step. I'll try to keep the answer short. So the first thing we did was we figured out this break in communication in our own entity. If that entity is only your own team, that's fine. That's the first thing. Because I tell you what, there are several teams, right? Let's say I have my frontline team of 4 or 5 guys who are my face to the team, and I want them to grow and start communicating. Because it can't be just Shalini always the voice. That will be the next question. Oh, then you are the only one-man army. What about the rest? I don't believe you can execute. Will be the next question when your idea gets accepted. Okay, by the end of your idea. So what they do is they start talking about to each individual, right? You have to build unity there. Which means each individual has to be committed to building product function from India. It's not about doing my product and going there and get that in your head first, okay? Whatever is in statement for you. Second is we built what we call as collaboration and ideation tools internally. It was to encourage the art of ideation, yes, that's definitely there for the masses. But at the product level, it was also to really document the entire process of where the idea gets locked, who is really driving it, put it on the global side. Now, even if somebody comes back in, even if somebody pushes back in, you have a documented way of talking about where the idea is. This is just a on-the-paper part. Third is, comes back to two things. As an idea owner, a product owner, do you have enough conviction to push? Because you are going to get at least 10 people telling you either your idea is nonsense or you don't have the team to do it. So let it be your idea, but it get executed somewhere else because they're all good, you know, they're very good people. Or they might say, you have so much already on your plate. Do you have bandwidth? You guys should be looking at increasing your productivity while you're talking of ideas, right? These are the questions which will come. So you have to have a way to separate your productivity measures, your innovation, do under the cover innovations, put proof of concepts, figure out every forum you have, you get to talk to your manager's manager. You have to have a way every month, go and sit wherever your headquarters is, in their face, figure out a way, first time, second time, third time, you get washed. We did that over the last, it didn't take 1 year.
Don't be last in the company, that's long.
It goes back to your, goes back to having a senior management influence. So I don't think you can really push to beyond an extent that the management team here also has to have that conviction. But the only way to get that done is if you can align with the business KPIs, okay? And you have to find a sponsor. If the sponsor is there and not here, it is a very difficult situation. That is what I said, I didn't want to talk to you. It's a very difficult situation. I would suggest you should still work with the sponsor out there and get this done, because at the end of the day, it's about, it's really going back to conviction. But at the same time, okay, this is a very important thing, a social security bit. For pushing one idea, if you think 100 jobs are at risk because there are several other relationships, it's not worth it. So as leaders, we also have to have that sensitive maturity. But that cannot stop us every time. So, I mean, I can give you hundreds of examples, but we have been doing this every day, so I can really feel your pain. And it's easier in some organizations, harder in some organizations because of the cultural setup. Culture, nothing that's to do with India or anybody else, it's really just the culture of the entity. What do we want to do? Do you even know what you want to be the next year? Is next year's vision statement for your company that I want to increase my productivity by 10%, then that's it, you are just there. You cannot talk of product idea, right? Because then you are capped there, right? So if you don't even have a word, innovation, transformation, anything around it in your overall entity, that's a very, very hard proposition. So I can feel the pain. So I can only help with what I can, what I have done in the past, but beyond it, I understand the pain.
I would probably want to ask, what are the steps that you took as part of, as you were mentioning about putting together, doing something beyond what you were expected to do, like...
we put the programs around it. We actually did institutionalized programs
around
it.
What are those things that you did?
Sure. I can talk to you about it. What's the time? I'll give you a 2-minute answer. We have something called as... in India, what we did was we actually sat together, forced our management team with lot of negotiation. Believe me, even in India, forget the senior management. Our own peers will say, "Boss, why are you struggling, right? You are adding problems to us. I mean, why can't you just let our lives be, right?" So you know all this. So okay.
The board said, "No."
That's it. Like, I want to go back home. I don't want to. Yeah. So okay. So the first thing we did was we found ways to add this as a topic in our monthly management meeting. It was the first step to just start talking about it. And we found ways where we could kindle this fire in the masses. Believe me, you're getting fresh grads. They want to change the world, okay? They want to be entrepreneurs. Not like our 40-year-olds who don't want to do anything. So, we used both angles, okay? That's the first thing. Look at that. I feel like I'm giving you some. Second thing is, we actually managed to get an India level strategy, which is beyond your parent strategy. Your headquarters strategy might be doing XYZ things. We put an India level strategy. We said we will do it. We call it as IFIT. So IFIT stands for two things. India future is today. So we want to think of future now. Second is I fit in this organization. So we wanted to make this as a statement which not just 40-year-old leaders talk about, every single associate who comes on board starts thinking about. So that's why it was meant to be an I fit. It talked of multiple things. We looked at how do we go closer to customers. We looked at how do we increase productivity, because that's bread butter. We can't let it go. We looked at how do we engage the right talent. We looked at how do we collaborate more internally here. Is there a way we can talk to each other more, which is not happening there, use that. We called it synergy, collaboration, next step became ideation. And we also put a program around just creating value. Creating value is what? Proposition and all these big words, right? Let's talk of, my job is, let's say I'm in an operations associate, not even a developer. All I have to do is copy a report from here, paste it from here, and I have to look at whether these two values match and send away. This is my job, let's say, okay? How do I add productivity here? How do I add value here? My first thing is there a way I can just write a macro which compares these two? People were already doing this in India, okay? It's nothing great. What we did as an organization was put a program around it. And we said, if you're adding value, we will start incentivizing that, which means each person has to think of what is value. That was the first step. It became a huge success. Actually, it's one of our biggest fueling engines for our growth. So several things like that. It's dependent on your culture, what you're bringing in. If you're a numbers organization, right, you want to bring in like, if your goal is, I want to be a 200,000 people organization, then your statement will be different. Our goal was, we want to be a boutique financial services specialist in India. I don't want to hire. Even now today, if I get 200 profiles, probably even 0 profiles get hired. Okay, that is my filter criteria. So in that case, I want people who are specialists. If I want to do that, I want to look at all these things. So which means I have to have every associate think of this and adding value at every level. Some of these things is both softer, it may not yield to this big, big ideas, right? But it gets you going in terms of a culture. And then questions start at every level, right? If you are not answering that questions and not handling your masses, there's only so much a management team can back off. So, I mean, what I gave you was like a quick way of thinking. It's really how you want to think about it from your organization perspective, and it's not easy believing. The only way to look at it is, are there inflection points in your organization which you can use? Good, bad, ugly, anything. If a fire is burning, is that a place to start using, putting in some change?
Zero wrong answer today. I last conversation with my CTO when he came down was, this is an R&D, right? Is it just a call center for you guys, or you just want to really do any R&D at all? Do you have any innovation labs? I want to actually start some innovation labs and get some traction on those stuff, you know. I want
to start small jobs for other advisors. For us to get an R&D lab, it took a few years, but we still did what we had to do in the setup. If you can show one customer facing success story, right, it changes conversation at least in a few places.
Because the other conversation that I wanted to have with him, I mean, I have been having it, but every time we visit US, I want to visit a customer. I just don't want to sit in office.
Good.
So that is
good. I make every fresher grad comes in. He spends at least 6 months because you don't want to put the guy in the fire.
Right.
6 to 8 months, you believe if the person is strong enough, send to wherever the customer is, not just US. Wherever the entity is, we say the only way we from India will start helping you in your business as part of the offshoring guideline is I want to have travel plans. That may change, by the way, with all legislations of Trump and Brexit. Let us see what happens, but that's a fundamental principle I have. And we have to push some of this, and it's an expense. Expense line is going to get affected. People aren't going to give you that money. You have to figure out a way. More than expense, the problem was cultural. It's like, if you come in, my guy over there is going to feel that, you know, same insecurity of jobs, nobody, they'll all block you, no information sharing. These are problems we have to face. Good news is, I think as India, we've matured a lot against all this. 20 years ago, when we used to go for transitions and all this nonsense, we didn't know how to talk to those people, or they could understand what we were saying. Today, we're a different community, right? So I think we have to recognize that. It goes back to the same point. I strongly believe, if we believe, push, we can get there. So I'm going to end it there. I could cover a lot of things, but it's okay. I think it was a great conversation.
I'll ask one question.
Sure.
Final one. Is when you are looking to hire in your team, in your organization, how much is the financial services, investment banking, domain knowledge required?
For product management, I would put it as about, if I take it as 100% composition, for me, I think I look at it in three aspects. One is I want the person who is coming on board with the right amount of communication, negotiation, just articulation skills for me is number one. I've hired people from all sectors because I think product management, not for business analysis, because the order changes there. Number two, hard product skills, right? How do you draw a roadmap? How do you manage a backlog? How do you coordinate? Do you know how to manage your requirements, etc.? So that becomes part two. The domain comes next. Because I believe we can teach domain. We have been doing that every day. We have enough programs to do it. So I believe we can do that. It's the first two which are harder. The second one also probably, you know, institutes like you can teach. First one is the hardest. That all depends on me. So I don't think that's an answer, but
yeah.
I always look out for those people, so.
Because I think that my product doesn't know the product problem.
I'm sorry?
My product doesn't know the product problem, because... I just need a
person who can sell.
Right. But that also, I doubt it.
Seriously, I thought this was fantastic. I think we should show that to every product manager. Rocket Sing is a...
So one last thing, talking about that innovation ecosystem, right?
Yes.
So you said there's no problem in following what's happening, the way they do it in Silicon Valley. So what do you think is lacking here to have such kind of an ecosystem?
You mean the macro ecosystem beyond the organization or within the
organization? Yeah, the macro ecosystem, the innovation ecosystem that you have, say, in the west of the Silicon Valley.
Beyond it?
Yeah, so what is it that we lack here, and what are, let's say, three things that we lack and three things that we should do to get there?
I think
we definitely lacked the whole startup ecosystem being formalized earlier. I think we are doing definitely fantastic right now. India has built up a lot. That was one thing which is in Silicon Valley really engaged the whole culture, right? Of how can you have startups really get that amount of attention at people who hold startups. That's where getting a lot more VCs is helpful, but at the same time, they can help you, they can push you in wrong decisions. That's one. Second is engaging academia is not something which we do very well in India. Colleges do what they want to do, and organizations do what they want to do, customers do what they want to do.
A lot of research over there gets done with academia.
A lot of research gets done in partnership between academia and organization. And all the forward-looking thing, you're working hand-in-hand. For example, data. Data scientists are sitting with the business team and doing it. That's one thing which from Broadridge India we have been focused on the last few years. You know, we are closely partnering with research scientists because we have superb scientists in India. IISc, IIIT, local institutes. You don't have to go, you know, to the top research ones. Just the local institutes if you start engaging. That's one, it's part of the ecosystem. Third is, I don't know if we can really solve this. It goes back to Gautam, right? Gautam's point, the societal aspect. So that will continue. I mean, I talked about that point. Right? Look at this room, right? Two ladies. Why? You're leaving out 50% of the talent pool. You look at any Western organization, account management, sales, product management, even in a traditional world like banking world, you have more women there than men. Because they're considered better customer facing than men. Do you know that? Yeah. Do we even believe that in India? So that's just one example, right? I mean, I may be talking about women, I mean, I'm thinking because I'm a woman, nothing like that. I feel that pain because in my talent pool, it's fantastic people, but pushing it ahead, societal issues. There are several things about societal aspects, right? Cultural, we spoke about. We are scared to talk of things which we know. We've done it for 20 years and we are scared of talking about it because we believe the other guy knows. Just because he has an accent, he has a white skin. It's not just his problem, by the way, it's our problem too. Okay? So.
And then, Shalini, what do you think about the whole failure being a badge of honor in Silicon Valley?
Mm.
How do you see that in the Indian ecosystem?
That's a great point. I think we are super scared of failure. Super scared of failure. I don't completely agree with that principle though of failure being a badge of honor, because you know, I think that's reducing a little bit also, because I think nature is playing its forces, it's neutralizing the cash flows. But in our case, it goes back to my point, right? I think we have to have the guts to start figuring out how to fail fast. That's the first thing. If you want to fail fast. It goes back to somebody's unstable technology question, right? Do it, but fail fast. But that is a cultural thing, and it's a harder battle.
So, this is one aspect for you to fail. What my data is doing, what my parents is doing, what my father's, whatever
it is. It's about your wife.
Thank you.